living up. This is America. Fuck that slipping up. Look how I'm living up. All these
Hello, everyone. Hello.
Oh, hello. Hello. I want to welcome everyone to Perspectives with a Black with Black Men. Today's topic is thriving, not just surviving, being under 25. And we have four educated, brilliant, passionate young men here today to talk with us about their experiences and how they continue to thrive and in what ways they do that. So I want to introduce to you our panel for today. And our panel today is, we start with Akil, who is 25, who is joining us today. So I want to welcome you to the panel today. All right. Well,
thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you, MJ. I'm glad to be here and weigh in with my perspective. That's everything that's going on, as well as share my experience. I'm from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Went to Florida A&M University, which is an HBCU. Graduated there with my business administration degree in undergrad, and then also got my master's degree from there. And now I currently work with the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
Okay. All right. So next we have Imokhai. He is 24. And I want to welcome him to the panel as well.
How's it going, everyone? My name is Imokhai Okolo. I'm from Akron, Ohio. Recent graduate of the University of Akron School of Law. In the process of studying for the bar exam. I also do a lot of community organizing work here in Akron with The Womb, which is a community organizing group, The Way of Mind and Body, located on East Market Street.
All right. Thank you very much. Next, we have 23-year-old Caleb. He's going to join us.
Everybody, my name is Caleb Broadous. I am a recent graduate of the Kent State University with my bachelor's in exercise physiology, and I'm currently working in the emergency medical services field. hometown, by the way, is Nashville, Tennessee, but I currently reside in Cuyahoga Falls. Forgot that.
All right. There we go. I never knew. I don't think I knew about the Nashville thing. All right.
For a minute.
Pretty cool. All right. So next we have our final panelist, Frantz, who is 23 as well.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for having me, NJ. I really appreciate it. Share my perspective for today. Currently, right now, I attend the University of Central Florida, and I'm pursuing my degree in business administration and also minoring in professional sales. I'll be graduating this fall, and I'm located in Orlando, Florida.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So before we get started, I just want to let everyone know that we will be taking questions that you have for our panel. Just put them right there in the comments, and one of us will see it, and we will get a chance to ask that at the end with the time that we have left. We do have a few questions that we're going to start off with. And so we're just going to start off with the very first question. So the first question is talk to us about your experience as a Black man, hearing statistics around what Black men should and are capable of, what have you done, I should say, to try to defy some of those statistics? Oh, and we're going to start with Akil.
Well, just to get started, one of the statistics that, you know, rings loudly in my head is the statistics that you always hear about one in every three Black men being placed in jail. I think that's something that is, you know, we can look at some of the systematical things that, you know, are in place that contribute to that number. But one thing is that, you know, education is very important. And, you know, I think that we have to continue to educate ourselves and strive for education. I know Nelson Mandela said education is the most powerful tool in which we use to change the world. And I think that, you know, that holds true. And we have to continue to educate each other, whether it be on a number of different issues, from voting to government, you know, procedures. But when I think about, you know, that number, you know, it really makes me, and that statistic, it really makes me, you know, kind of wonder. And I strive to be an example to, you know, young kids from whatever background, whatever demographic, that, you know, you can be whatever it is, you know, that you want to be. And everybody comes from, you know, a different background, but, you know, there's opportunity that is, there's opportunities that are, you know, out there. And I think that we have to show those bright spots and those bright lights in our community, in our Black men, as, you know, so often society may shine a bad light on that. So, you know, personal experiences that, you know, we just have to keep striving to go higher.
One second, I think we're getting some technical difficulties, so let's try to figure that out for a second. Hold on. Okay, so it looks like we're good. It's just frozen on this end, but it's good. So, all right, so we're gonna go ahead and continue. Thank you, Akil, for those comments. So we're gonna go next to Imokhai.
Hit me with the question one more time, NJ.
The question is, growing up, when you heard the statistics about Black men, the negative statistics, what have you done to kind of keep yourself motivated to defy those statistics?
I think for me, the biggest thing that keeps me motivated to defy those statistics is, I guess, learning more about my people. I know one of the things is that, you know, we as Black people, as, you know, African people are powerful beyond measure, right? Our ancestors have endured things that we couldn't even imagine, right? We are resilient people, a powerful people, a determined people. And the more I learn about our people, the struggles that we've been through and what we've accomplished in this country and the culture that we built, I mean, you know, us as Black people, we literally built this country, right? And so knowing that and knowing that what we're capable of keeps me motivated, keeps me going. You know, I'm really passionate about helping my people. And so I see it like in myself, that, you know, in order for me to be able to help my people most, I need to also achieve, right? I need to also, you know, I guess defy the odds or do what I can to best position myself to be able to help people as best as possible. So for me, what that looks like is, you know, being able to go to law school, being able to graduate, you know, become an attorney, be able to help my people on the legal ends, and just do my part, I guess, as well as, you know, working with youth. I have a nonprofit organization. And so I guess doing those kind of community efforts and those community things to teach our youth about us being resilient people, and also, you know, working with my peers, my coworkers, to be resilient people as well.
All right. Thank you very much, Caleb.
So I have an interesting perspective just because I do have a little bit of intersectionality because I'm both Latino and Black. So growing up, a lot of the things that I heard was that because obviously they automatically associate me with Mexican because that's the only form of Latin America that a lot of America knows of, when there's also Puerto Rico. But my mom's Puerto Rican, so I heard a lot of, oh, you Mexicans don't know anything but work. All you guys know is yard work. All you guys know is manual labor. And then on the Black side of things, I've heard a lot of Black on Black violence, Black men in prison, and the prison school to prison pipeline, and how most Black men are never going to achieve anything, how they're underachievers. And again, none of that was, well, I shouldn't say none of it, but majority of it was never expressly directed at me. It was just in the subtleties that I had experienced growing up. But thankfully, I was blessed to have my father in my life. And the greatest advice that he ever gave me was, he pulled out a white sheet of paper. He put a black dot on that white sheet of paper. And he said, this is you. The entire world is going to be able to see you, because the only thing that you see against the background of white is the black dot. And so you can look at that in two ways. One, that all the pressure is going to be on you. You have all the pressure in the world on you, and you have no choice but to succeed, because if you fail, everyone will see it. Or that you're the star of the show and everyone's going to look to you. So you have every opportunity to show them how great that you can be. So I chose and decided to look at it in the latter form. And I've been able to do that through graduation of just college and just being able to get further into my medical career in the emergency medical services.
Frantz, you're next.
So a statistic that I found out growing up is the education in Black men. 50% of us go to college to get our associate degree, and about 19% of us graduate with a bachelor's degree or higher. For me, the way I want to change that is for me to obtain my bachelor's degree this fall. And once I complete that this fall, I want to go back to my community college where I was home. So I was in a 2-year program called Bridge Success Program, and it really helped out the diversity students. So I want to go back and give my time to them to really help them, guide them through their college journey. Because right now it's pretty hard. It's hard for us to go to college without having a support system. So I want to be that support system to go back to my alumni school and really just give them the knowledge that I possess for me to continue my journey. And I really want to do this by doing like some guest speaking and just go to different schools, and also to trickle down to high schools and middle schools and elementary schools to really get our Black community to go to college and pursue their education.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for sharing that. So we've heard the statistics, and you've heard them throughout your life, and you've had experiences with them. So can you talk to us about any experiences you've had directly with racism or racial profiling or police driving while Black? Can you share with us any of your direct experiences that you've had as a young man?
Yeah, So in high school, when I was walking back.
With Akil, I'm sorry.
He could. We'll go ahead. Let him finish.
Okay. Go ahead, Akil.
I'm sorry about that. Well, go ahead.
Yeah, so we're gonna go.
Yeah, well, what I would say in my experience is that I don't think that it has to be necessarily a direct experience to where somebody may call you out of your name or anything like that. But I think it's just the shoes that you walk in, you know, every day is that, you know, you realize who you are. You realize the environments that you're in. And I think that, you know, it's something that you really have to embrace in the world, you know, that we live in. And I had went to a predominantly, you know, white high school, and I know that I had a lot of support there where I was at. But sometimes when you walk in a room and you realize that you're the only, you know, Black person in that room, you're the only Black, you know, male in that room, is that, you know, you have to go in and carry yourself with a certain attitude that, you know, I belong here and I'm just as qualified as everybody else. And I'm just as intelligent, just as educated. And, you know, I'm just as powerful as everybody else is in this room. And I think that's something that, you know, we have to keep in mind, because there's a lot of places that we'll go that we will go that aren't, you know, diversified, that there may not be people in the room, you know, that look like us. And I think that, you know, we are representing not only us, but we're representing, you know, our families, we're representing our cities, we're representing our communities, our schools, our churches, whatever it is that it may be. And that may also give somebody else an opportunity that comes after us. So I think that we have to realize where it is that we're at, the power that we carry as, you know, the people that we are, and not be diminished or not let our light be dimmed by some of the uncomfortable places that we may find ourselves in, but, you know, shine bright like the, you know, people and the stars that we were meant to be.
Wow. Thank you. Imokhai.
I guess for me, I'm definitely, I'm blessed and privileged in a sense to not have many too sketchy interactions with the police. You know, I try to stay away as best as possible. And, you know, I haven't really had too many like direct incidents of like, you know, racism, like nigger to your face kind of deal, right? You know, I've heard people, you know, shout out cars that are driving by, right? I went to Miami University in Oxford, Ohio. So, you know, driving down to, like, walking down the street, high street, you know, you might hear someone drive past and yell nigger, you know. But, you know, in that place too, you see so many microaggressions, right? Dealing with individuals who just are maybe ignorant, don't know any better, or just don't care. You deal with microaggressions all the time, right? People not believing you belong in certain spaces, or maybe not necessarily believing that you can do the things that you told them you've done. You know, being a Black law student, you know, I see it all the time. You know, I tell people that I'm a law student, their face kind of lights up a little bit, like as if they're surprised, or it's, you know, not expected that I could be a law student. I'm blessed to have done very well in law school. I'm very proud of that fact. And so I tell people I've done well in law school, and like the eyes light up, right? You know, there's a lot of, you know, stereotypes around Black students not doing well in law school, not being able to be at the top of their class. And, you know, I've defied those statistics, and you see people, and you tell people that, right? And, you know, you see the shock on their face or the look, and it's just kind of like they look at you differently, or you can tell they thought some kind of way before, and now it's just kind of like, oh, you know, different. So, you know, microaggressions and just being in spaces that are predominantly white all the time, you definitely just have that, I guess, weight, that burden, and you're kind of sometimes just walking on eggshells, right? Being the only Black person in the room, definitely uncomfortable, right? You know, I worked in many workspaces, worked at law firms with, you know, over 150 attorneys, and like one's Black, like, you know, so definitely being in those spaces has been challenging. But it's definitely given me perspective, right? Perspective to do the work that I do in this movement. So I guess I can say I'm very blessed for that fact and that perspective.
Thank you. Caleb?
So I had a very different experience growing up. I grew up, like I said, in the South, Nashville, Tennessee, Missouri, things of that nature. And being in the South, people are a little bit less hesitant to put up airs that they are not racist. I've been called the N-word multiple times by my peers. I have been physically attacked by people. I have had to fight literally physically other people because of the oppression that they would put upon me. So there's that. And there's also the microaggressions that I experienced all throughout high school as well. Words like, oh, you're too white to be black. Oh, you talk so great for a black boy or a black kid. And then I would also hear things like, I can't, like one instance, I had an administrator tell me, I can't believe that you would show out in front of these people right now. You're a representative for your own people. And I'm just like, how am I the single sole representative, you know? And in college, it wasn't as bad. Obviously, you have a very large melting pot of different ideologies and different perspectives on life. And some people are a little bit less tolerable than others. Even at Kent State, I've even had to face either blatant racism or just, again, microaggressions in the workplace as well, whether it have been at jobs that I worked at in high school or jobs that I worked at in college. It's been an experience for me, but I never chose to allow those moments to define me, because at the end of the day, their words are words. I choose who I want to be. I choose who I define myself as. I give myself my own identity. I choose the identity that I want to have. And I'm greater than any words that anyone has to say about me. I'm greater than the actions anyone wants to act toward me. And I believe that exact same thing for any and every black man, woman, and child out there. We're better than whatever they wish they could make us be.
Well, back in high school, I was walking back home from school, and I was just minding my own business, and like a police cruiser came by, and I was like, what's going on? And he got the car, came to me, and he was like, okay, you're not the person. So I was like, huh? At first, I really didn't thought about it that much, but then during that day, I realized I was probably descripted in the description what he saw, where it might be in a black person he thought it was me. And that really kind of upset me, man, because I don't want to be stopped by the police for any time they have a description of who they're looking for. I feel like that's a bad way to really handle that situation. And also too, during my time in high school and college, I deal with microaggressions. People say I act too white, and I'm like, what do you mean by that? And they say, yeah, you just act too white. Like you talk too proper. I was like, that don't make no sense to me. They say, yeah, you don't act like a typical black person. I was like, what? So just dealing with those microaggressions within that space, but I don't let that define me as who I am. I know I'm trying to be a leader in my community, and I want to show that we can overcome these microaggressions and also blatant racism. And I just want to go to the path and you talk to my younger people and also my older people to show that we make a difference and just have a smile on your face to continue to have a positive outlook, because they want us to see it go down. They want to oppress us. We have to continue fighting.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So I'm gonna attempt to share a video that hopefully, or maybe you've seen on Instagram or Facebook or what have you. And I wanna get your opinions.
As you said, right now, it's going to happen 10 years from now. In 26, you're going to be doing the same thing I'm doing. You understand that? 10 years, you're going to be right here too. So what I need us to do right now in 16 is to come up with a better way. And how we doing it, it ain't working. Be angry at 46. I'm angry at 31. You angry at 16.
Okay,
do you understand me?
Did that? Hopefully that worked. Were you guys able to see that? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
All right. Yeah. So, thinking one, is that your first time seeing that clip?
My second time seeing that clip.
Okay. So when you see a clip like that, and you hear the frustration and the passion in the 30-something-year-old man's voice, and you see and hear the frustration and anger in the 40-some-odd-year man's voice, and then you see the look of hopelessness and confusion, and even at the end there, you see the young man brighten up to maybe even look like he feels like maybe there is hope. You know, can you talk to us about, you know, what are your thoughts when you see something like that? And when you think about being under 25 or under, you know, what is your role in leadership moving forward? Thank you.
Yeah, NJ, and one thing that I would say is I know, you know, we see the frustration, we see the passion, we see the, you know, the hurt and the question of what is the solution. And my thing, you know, that I would say is, you know, we could say that it's not working and that we see the same thing time and time again. But, you know, I would say don't be discouraged because, you know, change is going to come. And when you stay encouraged and you continue to fight that fight, you know, one thing that we see is we see, you know, a death here. We see Trayvon Martin here, Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, and it's a 3-day post. It's a couple days of protest. It's, you know, 1 week of rioting or whatever it may be. But when you look back at the civil rights movement, the Montgomery bus boycott lasted 381 days. And, you know, here we are is that, you know, we might get energized or fired up at, you know, for 3 days or for a week or post on social media, but for 381 days, the Montgomery bus.
All right, Akil, is he only frozen on my end?
No.
Oh, okay. All right. So, Akil, brother, if you can join back in, we're going to go to Imokhai. And I'm
so determined that they didn't lose hope. This year in February, I stood in front of my church and I gave a speech, and the speech was titled "The Dream Lives On," and basically saying that this work is, you know, not done yet. That, you know, Martin Luther King had a dream, but, you know, there's still work for us to be done, regardless if there's multi-million dollar contract for athletes or large entertainment contracts, is that there's still injustice that we have in our community, still lives that are being lost, and we have to continue to fight because, you know, change is going to come as long as we stay encouraged.
All right. Thank you, Akil. I'm sorry you did cut out a little bit, but I think we got the gist of what you're saying. Some very powerful words there, but you did cut out for a minute. Imokhai?
You know, for me, I mean, as the guy, you know, he's not right. I mean, he's not wrong. You know what I'm saying? Right. That sense of hopelessness is there. For me, I find my hope in my faith in God. Right. And I also find my hope in the organizing work that I do and the people who are in this movement with me. And I'm able to find that hope because I've been able to find, you know, my people in this movement work and have a space where I can vent, a space where I can grow, a space where I can learn, and more importantly, a space where I can strategize, right? I feel determined because I have ideas, right? I've thought about it and I've kind of, you know, been able to see plans, see how things could possibly work. And I have like potential solutions that I've learned about and gotten from other people, right? And so I'm passionate and fired about the solutions because I'm like, hey, these ideas can work. These are some of the solutions that we have. This is what we can be pushing for. And so when I'm able to be in that space, I'm able to grow and strategize with people, that's where we find our power, right? Because there's power in people, right? And so when you can see that power and know that that power exists, I think it enables you to be hopeful. I'm constantly learning. I'm constantly trying to, you know, learn perspective from other people, see different people's views on different situations and learn more about, you know, economies, right? Learn more about different laws, right? Just kind of learn more about how we got here. And I think that sense of hopelessness for so many people is that they don't know what the solutions are, right? I think it's so important when we do organizing work to do political education, right? People, our education systems are so messed up, right? We don't learn the right things. We really don't learn about what capitalism is, right? We really don't learn about these systems that are the problem, right? You know, we understand that these are systemic issues, but we don't learn about those systems, right? And if you don't learn about those systems, you don't know how you can really change those systems. And so I think it's really important for us to learn those different facets of those systems, learn how we got here, and that's all through political education. And I think if we are able to get our people on board with that political education, people will feel so much more powerful, right? People will know what the next steps are, know who to hold accountable, know what to really blow up when we need to blow it up potentially, you know what I'm saying? So I think if we have that collective knowledge, that moves us so much farther down the line, and it makes so much more hopeful people.
Right. I appreciate that. And just for clarity's sake, I do this all the time because we do have some people who like to take words out of context. When you say blow it up, you don't mean actually using bombs. You actually mean starting a whole new process and ending what the current thing that we're doing now and starting all over. Correct?
Yes. Yes.
Please okay.
Don't take my words out of context. I'm yes. not trying to incite riots here. Okay.
Yes, yes. Thank you. Caleb?
Just kind of going along with actually what both Imokhai and Akil said, resounding that same gong that Imokhai hit on as far as that hopelessness, I can definitely say that there is both in the scientific realm and in the emotional realm that inheritance of hopelessness, that inheritance of rage, that inheritance of frustration, of just hurt and pain. And we've seen by different psychologists and how they have studied the Black plight and how it has actually been passed down from generation to generation. And that is something that we cannot ignore as a people, both within our Black communities, but also as just communities of underrepresented people. On top of that, I do also feel, and I am in the same camp as Akil, where we say it's not working. Peaceful peace is not the way. It hasn't worked for years. Well, in all reality, and all these events of Black people dying at the hands of police brutality and just being discriminated against by a systemic racism that is just ingrained within our country, we haven't fought that long fight. Peace. The another word for peace is long suffering. I feel like as a people, we have lost the ability to suffer through something with a goal in mind, and we've mastered the art of suffering, but we haven't mastered the art of suffering with a goal in mind. We haven't done that in quite some time, and I'm with Akil when he says that the bus riots were 387 days long. We will go for a week, a month maybe, of yeah. say their name, but everyone is always wanting to be a social justice warrior, but will not come through in the actual works themselves. And I'm not saying that's all across the board, but in order for the peaceful route to work, or any route to work, regardless, it needs to be done with full participation if possible. And if not, at least majority participation. And that's just something I don't see. It's something that I'm starting to see more now, which I'm really grateful for. And I hope that this continues past when it all blows over, because it really doesn't. It's just not in the media anymore. But I do hope that this is going to spark a trend and spark a revolution within our own people to where we start to go back towards full or at least majority participation in the movement to change our system and the system that is against us, that to create it to be one that's for us. So, yeah.
Thank you very much. Wow, brother, the comment about suffering, and that was powerful. Wow. Frantz, I'm sorry.
What I got from that video, it shows that we battling, man. We got to battle. We got to keep battling. The 40-year-old, he was battling. The 30-year-old, he was battling. I know the 16-year-old, when he get older, he gonna start battling, or start battling right now. Right now, we gotta make a change, a big change. And within that, the best way we can do that is educate our Black community and go out there and vote. If we vote for the leader that can help us move that change, then we can align all the ducks in one line. Because if we don't have a leader that promotes that racism is not right, then at the end of the day, we can try our hardest, but the leader can start, he can oppress us. So I say we have to get our young folks, our old folks, when you turn 18, we got to educate them the power of voting. Because voting will help us change that dynamic, change that leadership to help us thrive at the end of the day.
Wow, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you everyone for your thoughts on that video. That video moved me to tears in so many ways as we think about, you know, how do we pass the mantle, and also how this fight for racial justice and equality is one that is, you are suffering in the fight. When you are in the battle and you are trying to disrupt racism at every turn, it is exhausting. And the 40 some odd year old had lost hope and he was tired. And so, you know, when we ask you as the 25 and under, you know, at what point, when it's your turn is now, you know, we're looking to you for leadership. We're looking to you for innovative ways to move the needle and to make a change. So I want to thank you for that and move on to another question that's really top of mind as well. We all have friends, right? We all have friends, people who were our college roommates even, and who during this time and other times like this, we might have noticed some posts that they've made or some comments that they've made. So how do we reconcile loving our family and friends, but also knowing that they may feel differently about racism and the fight that we're in around racial justice? Akil?
I think that's kind of a tough question, because there'll be a lot of different perspectives, and some people may focus on the rioting and the looting, but not look at the root problem. And some people may want to highlight something else, but I think that you really have to bring it to people and meet people where they are at, and, you know, really kind of come in their world and sit down at their table and sit down beside them and help them to understand, because, you know, this, we're all humans and we're all living in this world together. And, you know, it's not, you know, like we've seen before, it's not a race issue. It's not a, you know, a black and white issue, but it's a human rights issue. And I think that anybody with the slightest bit of humanity would, you know, understand that there is a problem of how a certain type of people are being treated compared to another. And, you know, I have a lot of white friends, and I received a number of calls, you know, over the week, and just saying, you know, what is the solution? What can be done? Because, you know, I'm tired of this. I'm tired of seeing it. I'm tired of it happening, you know, wanting to bring people together. And I think that we all have platforms. It doesn't matter, you know, if we're in high school, if we're in college, if we're in our professions, but we all have platforms that we have to use to help promote and move the cause in the right direction, you know, in the right way, and understanding and strategizing and thinking about you know, how we do that. And the way that you travel a mile is to take one step at a time, and that step starts with a conversation. It starts with a community event. You know, it starts with bringing people together, and I think that's what we, you know, that's what we have to try to do in putting things into action, making it more than words.
You know, that's a tough question, right? You know, keeping relationships during this time is definitely interesting. You know, I guess my biggest thing, you know, one of the greatest lessons I've learned from my mom, you know, is to give people grace, right? You know what I'm saying? My mom taught me a lot about grace, you know, having grace for other people because they come from different perspectives and, you know, understanding that, you know, people just don't have the same perspective that I do, have the same experiences that I do. So to give people grace, especially during tough times, right? And so I definitely try to do that with folks. You know, I'm very open to have conversations. I'm very open to learn, very open to educate folks. But, you know, it is definitely tough, you know, because at the same time, you got to guard your mental health at the same time. Because sometimes I just don't have it in me to go back and forth with some of these people out here because it's just, you know, this the ignorance or what have you is just, you know, it's beyond me. So, you know, sometimes I just don't have that energy. So I try to stay back, you know what I'm saying? At the same time, you know, if you've seen my, you know, recent Facebook and Twitter these past couple of days, I've had the time to go back and forth with people. So I have been doing just that. And so, you know, I try to keep it respectful, right? You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, also, I've realized that, you know, I'm okay to disagree with folks. It's okay. You know, I've learned that's one of the big lessons I've learned in life is that everybody's not going to agree with Imokhai, and that's okay. You know, so I've learned to, you know, agree to disagree. But at the same time, I tell people, you know, we can disagree on politics. That's fine. But when we start to disagree about, you know, humanity, you know, the dignity of people, that's where I can't, you know, I can't rock with you. If you don't see the dignity in me and Black people and people generally, that's something I can't rock with you. We can't agree to disagree on that because that's just not going to work for me. So I think, you know, I've tried to, you know, find those lines where they be. But you know, it's tough during this time. Keeping relationships are tough during this time because people showing their true colors, right? But at the same time, we've seen a lot of solidarity. You know, have I necessarily agreed with this recent Blackout Tuesday? You know, I personally, you know, don't agree with that organizing tool. I see how people do agree with that organizing tool. But I think one thing it's shown is that a lot of people are in solidarity. You know, I've seen a lot of people posting black squares that I ain't seen post about none of this stuff ever. You know, so that's, you know, nice to see that, they, you know, they're with us. So, you know, but that's a whole other conversation. So I'm gonna leave it at that.
Thank you. Yeah, finishing your law degree would give you more time.
It does.
Caleb.
I am not gonna tell anyone to do anything specific because this is how I handle the situation. This is my recommendation. At the end of the day, you get to choose how you would like to approach it. But in the great words of Timotheus Pope, the director of Summer's Best 2 Weeks out in Rector, Pennsylvania, seek to understand before you seek to be understood. That has been something that has really helped me, not just in this time, but in all times. Because I used to not be the most understanding individual. I was like, no, I'm rock solid in my beliefs and in my thoughts, and that's the only way there is, and that's my way, the highway. When in all reality, because of the faith that I have in Jesus Christ, he's called me to understand and to love on other people well. And in order to love other people well, that means that I need to understand, hey, something that I might believe is truth and fact may need to change and alter and adjust in order to really shape my worldview correctly. And so I always seek to understand why someone else might see different than me. But kind of like how Imokhai said, if you are now questioning someone's rights as a human being, regardless of whether it be in this situation or a different situation, I'm going to fight you on it. I'm going to argue. I have the time. I'm going to have a heated discussion, a passionate discussion to let you know, like, hey, the way that you're perceiving it, regardless of whether you believe in the same belief that I believe, and if you believe in something different, if you believe in the political sphere and only the political sphere, it doesn't matter. Humanity and human rights, the unalienable rights that our country loves to express so much, is for everybody. It's not just for one specific group, or it's not just for the people that haven't committed crimes. It's not just for the people who aren't the same color as me or who are the same color as me. It's for everybody. It's not for the people who identify differently than me. It's for everybody, period, point blank. And I'm also in the same camp that says, hey, I love you, but I'm gonna love you from all the way over here. Because just because I love you doesn't mean I need to keep you close to my heart, because I still need to protect and guard my own heart as well, and guard and protect the hearts of the people around me. So if that means I have to put you at an arm's length, even if you're family, that's what that means. It doesn't mean I hate you. That doesn't mean I look poorly upon you. That doesn't mean that let me rephrase that. I try to not look poorly upon you. That doesn't mean that I will never love you, that I will never interact with you ever again. No, it just means that right now, in order to process what you've just said to me, in order to come to terms with the state of our relationship now, and in order to learn how to reconcile with you and turn back into a relationship with you, we need to separate and create distance. So I would recommend that people do those two things. Always seek to be, understand before seeking to be understood. And then if you can't find a common ground, and if there is no compromise, separation is a beautiful thing. Hit that block button.
All right, thanks, Caleb.
So for me, I feel like it's all about a conversation first. We're gonna talk to those individuals that have that different view, that don't see eye to eye. And we wanna just try to figure out, have a friendly conversation. So if I have some friends or family that's having a disagreement with how things are going right now, I'm gonna talk about it to see where can we see where there's no logic. And where there's no logic, and there's no conversation to have. So I'm gonna go about my way and speak on terms of what they believe and then what I believe. And then if there's no logic in it, I'm gonna call them out on it. I'm gonna say, hey, I don't agree with you this way or that way. And then hopefully they can see that their way of thinking is not the right way of thinking. But if it's not possible, I most definitely will separate myself from that individual, separate myself from the individual, so then I won't be consumed with that negativity. At the end of the day, we do have to protect our hearts and our mental aspects. And I need all the positive energy I can get. So with that individual, I'll have a conversation with them. If it don't go the way it should go with logic and what's the right way to do for humans, then I can't get along with them. And I'll just separate myself. And then if I'm living with the situation and go to extreme, I might remove myself from the space. Because we all got to protect our mental health and our hearts and what we believe in. It doesn't matter who is against us.
And if you don't mind, one last thing, could I add?
Okay.
I know that we talk about us separating ourselves, and I think that sometimes that we have to do that. But I would also say that we, like I said, bring stuff to people where, they're at. Is that, we may have white friends, we may have family. And, if it were me and I'm talking to you, and if it were me that were laying on the street, dead, that were getting killed by the police or that were getting shot in the back, if you say that you're my friend, you say that you love me, how would you feel about that? Because this isn't just about somebody that you don't know, that we don't know. This could be me. This could be my brother. This could be your son, your daughter. This could be, any one of us. And it's, we may have to separate ourselves sometimes, but when you look at me and you say that you love me and you say that you're my friend, then, hey, I need your help in this thing. We all need your help in this thing, because at any point it could be me.
Yeah, that's a real statement and something that we all should consider when we're talking with anyone, especially those who may not agree or may have wonder why we're talking about race or equity again. Why? Oh, there he goes with that conversation. I get that a lot, actually, since I work in diversity and talk about it a lot. So the next question that we have two more prepared questions that we're going to ask, and then we're going to open it up to the questions that are in the live box, and then wrap it up. But I want to ask, as you think about being professionals, and there's this conversation or this thought process that people say, you know, we have a board of directors, and they are the people who help guide us through difficult situations. A lot of Black men have talked about that. So can you talk about your board of directors, whether or not you have one, what are your thoughts on it, and what does it mean to you? We'll start with Akil.
Yeah, I think these are definitely some tough questions, and I don't know if I want to speak directly to a board of directors, but just in the workplace and how, you know, you go about having that change, how you go about carrying yourself and still, you know, wanting to, you know, bring attention to something. I think that's, you know, it's definitely tough. And I think that there's a number of ways that you just have to think about that. And one is, you know, every day when I walk into, you know, my building, I'm trying to carry myself like a proud, you know, young, educated Black man, because there's a stereotype out there that, you know, you may not belong, or your education may not be valued, or they just may not expect what you say to be articulate and on point as it might be. But I think that that's what you have to remember, is that, you know, when you go somewhere, you know, you may be the only Black person that somebody at your workplace, you know, encounters. So, and I think you hold your head up, pull your shoulders back, and, you know, carry yourself and be, you know, be proud, and, you know, don't be afraid to have those conversations, but, you know, think about it in the way that we are, in the way that we're having them. And I think that, you know, that's the tough thing to do. And then the last thing that I would say is, you know, as you carry yourself in that way, then I think that your, you know, your workplace will respect you, as well as, you know, another thing is, if the values don't align with, you know, who you are, you feel like you're being respected, I think you take it to that person or that supervisor and speak up in the right way by pulling somebody aside and saying what it is that you have to say.
I know for me, having a board of directors in your life is extremely important. I see boards of directors as like mentors and sponsors of mine, people who I go to for certain information. If I got a question, I'm going to a certain individual I already know off the bat. And so when I think of board of directors, I think of people who are helping me build perspective, right? Because I have major decisions in life, right? You know, when I was deciding on what job I was going to have after law school, I got multiple job offers. I'm juggling. I'm like, I don't know what to do. I call up the board of directors. You know, I call certain people who I ask certain decisions. And, you know, I think it's important to understand that you control your board of directors, right? Like any other corporation. So I hire and I fire board of directors. You know what I'm saying? If I feel as though someone's maybe not giving me the best advice here, you know what I'm saying? It's your time is up on my board. You know what I'm saying? If I got to add, I meet new people all the time, and I'm always accepting applications for board members. So, you know, folks out there who got, you know, experience and perspective that want to give me, you know, I can add you to the board. You know, I'm always accepting applications. But I think it's important to build that perspective in life, right? You know what I'm saying? You don't know what you don't know. So if somebody else, you know, shows you, exposes you to something you just didn't know, you're like, makes you think about something differently, right? Helps you build perspective, helps you make that better decision at the end of the day. So I think as young Black men, you got to have a board of directors. And they got to be a solid board of directors, a diverse board of directors. You know, I got Black, white, Latino, you know, I have, you know, white. I mean, I have like, you know, man, female, you know what I'm saying? I have a variety of diverse folks on my board of directors. And it's just, they've helped me through life. And you, it's really hard to make without a board of directors. You know what I'm saying? A company thrives off its board of directors. So if you ain't got a strong board, you need to, you know, rework, liquidate, something.
Just real quick, NJ, can you repeat the question for me one more time?
Yes, it's just your thought around the idea of having board of directors or a group of mentors, basically, to help guide you. And what experiences do you have with it, and what do you think it means?
So I'm kind of like with Akil and Imokhai again. Having a board of directors is extremely important, because if you're only looking through your little pinhole view of what the world is and how to operate within it, that's not a holistic view. And so you need people that have a differing mindset from you to give you a different perspective, but you also need people that are aligned with your views and aligned with your perspective as well to help you see from all the different angles that you're looking at as well. So I think having a board of directors, especially one that is populated with people that are much older than you, who have gone through the different aspects and ways of life and to have that wisdom that can then pour it into you, to have people that are there for you in your corner to help guide you spiritually as well, to have people in your corner that can help you, again, see and understand the different perspectives of different types of people. Like Imokhai was saying, people that are female, people that are part of the LGBTQ plus community, people that are a part of different religious spheres. Like, it's very important to be able to get a holistic view and to be able to truly understand what the world is and how it's perceived from different angles. That way you can then go out and then be a better representative, not just for yourself, not just for your different communities, but for the world in general. So I do believe that having a board of directors is extremely important, and I'm thankful to have a very diverse set myself.
So currently right now, I'm still in college right now, so I'm not in the real world right now with the board of directors, but from hearing these men, I know I want a board of directors that can pour wisdom into me, that be diversified. I don't want to have a board of director that's all white, that's all black, that's all Asian. I want to have diversity. I want to have a Spanish person here, a black person there, an Indian person there, girl, female. And then I want them to be all positive on the outlook of helping the people under them. And I want them to pour into me with as much knowledge as they possibly can, so then I can then later on pour information to my counterparts. So I want a board of directors that has diversity, that can really pour information, because knowledge is power.
Wow, thank you very much. And Frantz, I wouldn't say you don't have a board of directors. You may just not call it that. So we all need mentors, and I'm sure you have some. And then also we need sponsors. So I've been stuck on this once I got introduced to it by the Faculty Diversity Center about sponsorship, and you need people who are going to speak for you when you're not in the room and speak highly of you so that you one day can get in the room. And you need mentors who are going to know you and you can have that unfettered anger and frustration. You can let those type of things out so they can help guide you through some of your decisions. Now, a sponsor may not be someone that you have consistent interaction with. It may not be someone who you're going to be able to be have as a mentor. Sometimes we get confused sometimes we think that our sponsors should be our mentors. And so when they don't show up for us the way we expect mentors to show up for us, we get a little frustrated and then want to end that relationship. And I think that's harmful for us, because we need sponsors and people that we check in with often, who know who we are and what we can do and can speak for us and help put us in positions. But we also need those mentors that we can have more easily and readily access to. So that is, those are two different things, I think, but they will both will be on your board of directors, if you will. And in a board of directors, everybody have a different role. And some people are just the people that's gonna bring other resources to you. They're not gonna come to all the meetings.
It's about them committees.
Right, exactly. You gotta have committees, right? So no, that's real talk. So I'm gonna go to the last question, which is really thinking through just as you go through your daily life, being 25 and under, all but one of you have graduated college. Francis very close to graduating college, and you've all been through things, and you will go through things. But as you think about everything that you've been through and everything that you know that you can at least see is coming for you as you enter or continue to walk through your professional life, can you talk to us about how you stay grounded? You know, how do you remain hopeful?
Akil?
I think staying hopeful is going back to what I was saying about staying encouraged. One, my first and most fundamental way for me personally, no, it's not for everybody, but, you know, is in my faith. And then, you know, my faith keeps me grounded, but also my family and leaning on that support that you have, that board of directors that you have, those people that you can go to that you know are going to have you through thick and thin. That's, you know, how you stay grounded and stay encouraged. And then realizing that, you know, you have a purpose and everybody has a purpose. And the sooner that you're able to realize what that purpose is, then the sooner you're able to go out and fulfill that purpose. And, you know, me personally, you know, I want to be able to make an impact and change, you know, the world. And I think when we talk about a call to action for our communities is that, you know, we may have mentors, but we can mentor that next young brother, that next young Black boy, and let him know that, you know, hey, I went to college, I graduated college. These are the opportunities that I've been able to create for myself. These are the things that I've been able to do that I never imagined possible for myself because I worked hard, I stayed committed, I, you know, stayed in school, I stayed out of trouble. And I think that those are the things that we have to, you know, be able to see. We have to be able to see them for ourselves, and then we have to be able to show them to others as well. And I think that, you know, when people come together, there's power in numbers. And one thing.
I think you muted yourself, brother.
Create economic opportunities for my communities. And I think that when we come together and when we make ourselves educated, one, you know, financially educated and understand how system and processes and laws work, then those things are, you know, possible. And I think last thing is that I would encourage everybody, you know, we have to get out to, we have to get out to vote. You know, I think that we dropped the ball this past election with not voting. And I think that we realize how important that is. But staying encouraged is, I mean, it's something that we, you know, you have to wake up and do daily and really start with the end goal and keep that in mind.
You know, for me, I know I, sorry, I have some difficulties here. I know I spoke on this earlier a little bit, but, you know, my church family definitely keeps me grounded. I go to the House of the Lord in Akron, Ohio. I've been going to the House of the Lord since I was like three. My church fam is definitely my family away from home. We meet every Sunday. We still have groups going, you know, Defenders of Faith. So my church fam definitely keeps me grounded. So shout out to the House of the Lord family. You know, my the people I'm in the movement with, right? You know, I work at the I work with the womb, the Way of Mind and Body, and those folks, you know, shout out, you know, Ray Green, Garita Davis, you know what I'm saying, Jen Toles, Sarit Sierra, Shantae, Chris, you know, all those folks at the womb, Paul, you know, so many names, Miss, you know, Miss Bora, you know, so many names, right? But that family there keeps me grounded. Because I know there's people in here that are fighting for the freedom and liberation of my people. And so they definitely keep me grounded, just learning more. And, you know, I think it's important for people to just kind of, you know, protect their peace at the same time, right? You know, so find spaces that allow you to be you, you know, spaces that allow you to thrive, be joyful, you know what I'm saying? Spaces that allow you to organize, spaces that allow you to kind of just live a full life at the same time while all this chaos is going on. And, you know, I've definitely found various spaces and various communities that definitely keep me grounded. You know, I have the Akron Urban League, Young Professionals family. We do a lot of great work in the city. We're on and popping, you know, bigger and better things to come. Stay on the lookout for us. Shout out to those young folks. If you want to join the Akron Urban League, hit me up. You know, I can let you know. I'm recently going up to Cleveland. I'm moving to Cleveland and working at a law firm up there. And there's a gang of Black lawyers in Cleveland that are doing some great work. You know, they got their hands in government. They got their hands in big law, small businesses, nonprofit game, in-house work. You know, there's a gang of Black attorneys, and I get fueled and fired from that because there are not many Black attorneys out here doing the thing. And there are a squad of Black attorneys in Cleveland, even in Akron too, who are doing just great work. And so those people definitely keep me grounded. And so really, for me personally, and I think it's important to understand that what keeps people grounded is a very personal thing, right? What keeps you level-headed? What keeps you, you know, at peace? And for me, it's that idea of building community. I love building community. I love joining community. I love being in community and connection with people. I thrive off people. And so when I find those communities, I find my people, I'm grounded, I'm at peace, so.
As far as what keeps me grounded, again, to voice what Akil and Imokhai said, my faith family, the people that I know that are followers of Jesus Christ, shout out to Neo Impact on Kent's campus and everyone that's a part of that organization across the nation. Just the shortest that I brushed with you guys keep me grounded and help me to remind myself that there is hope. And it may not be coming in this world, but I know that there is hope that's coming after I pass. Also, on top of that, I also have the community that I've just grown through the friends that I've made at Kent's campus, the friends that I've held since my high school experience, the friends that I've had at the different churches I've attended in Akron, Ohio. Definitely still have people from the House of Lord, Tristan Clark, you know, Imokhai over here. So that as well. And then also going to the board of directors that we were just talking about, whether it be in direct contact, whether it be in just me seeing your different posts on your social medias, seeing how you guys stand and seeing how you guys are there for the people that you mentor, the people that you advocate for, that gets me pumped up. That gets me fired up and reminds me like, hey, even though this is something that I may deal with for the rest of my life, the different situations and pains and frustrations that I might find as a Latino and as a African-American male, that there is still hope. That there is still a reason to fight. There is still a reason to climb. And then also last, but definitely not least is my family, because of the fact that, you know, they've been there since I was born. You know, they were the people that are constantly encouraging me, constantly reminding me that I am a son of the Most High God, that I am blessed, that I am blessed and highly favored, that I am definitely capable, that I am smart enough, that I am talented enough, that I am wise enough to accomplish these different goals that I know that the Lord's put on my heart, whether it be through serving my community, whether it be through being a leader in the medical field, the EMS field, a Black leader in that field, which is very rare to see. Those are definitely the ways that I am able to keep myself grounded and able to keep myself set on the hope that is before me.
What keeps me level-headed is looking at the end goal. The end goal is for me to graduate, go on my career in sales, and become a leader in sales. And then when I'm in my end goal, I'm going to come back and give back to my community and show them that it's possible for how I got here, that you can get here as well. So I want. So what keeps me fueled up, keep me going, is the fact that I can spread knowledge, spread love, to young Black boy, to young Black female, to any type of diversity. I want to give back to my community in a way that they didn't give back to me. I want to spread knowledge because knowledge is power. I want to educate them so they can empower themselves with the information that I bestowed upon them. And also to my family. Number one, my mom. My mom, she came from Haiti when I was three. She came from third world country. So she came for me to get a better opportunity. And I don't want to waste that chance. I want to come here and be the best I can be and just make her proud. And when I walk across the stage, I want to see her happy, be joyful. And I want to surround myself with positive individuals that keep feeding me information that's positive. Because myself, I'm a positive person. And then if I surround myself with negativity, I will also soak down the negativity. So when I see negativity come at me, I cut it from the roots. I don't let it manifest. So I surround myself being positive, always smiling, joke around, and just keep going. Like a famous movie said, just keep swimming. Gotta keep swimming.
That's awesome, Frantz. Thank you, everybody, for sharing. I always tell my students, especially those from diverse backgrounds and Black men specifically, that we have to remove quitting as an option. We have to take that off the table. And if you take quitting and if you take that off the table, then you have no other choice but to get up because you can't lay there. you have to get up. And so if you do that and every day you continue to move forward and you know that quitting isn't an option, you come up with better options. And those better options will be definitely more fruitful for you than quitting. And so moving on is, I have one more question. I'm going to ask that last, but I'm going to go to the questions that's been asked here. And the one question is from a person, one of my good friend's mothers, actually said, what is the single most important thing that a white person can do to be an ally? If you can try to figure out that and keep your answers to about 45 seconds.
I would say just acknowledging that there is a, you know, that there is injustice, that there is a problem, and that there is work that needs to be done, and that we make change when the people who aren't directly affected or who aren't being affected, you know, stand up, stand with, and stand together with the people that are being affected. So I think that it's not just Black people that are protesting or that are outraged or that are upset, but it has to be everybody. It has to, you know, be a united effort to make a change and bring equality up to everybody. And that's how, you know, that starts, is acknowledging it and, you know, wanting to make a difference and see a change just as much as the person being affected does.
You know, for me, so I recognize that, you know, a lot of people have different places in the movement, right? And a lot of people come from different places where, you know, one person is going to be a protester, somebody else is not going to be that person on the front lines protesting, right? And so there really is not one thing that all white people can do that, you know, to show their solidarity with the movement. But I think, you know, if you're a protester, you need to be out there laying bodies on the line. You know what I'm saying? If you got some bread, you need to be donating to these bailout campaigns, right? You need to be donating to these community organizing groups. If you know a judge, you need to make a phone call. If you know a mayor, you need to make a phone call. You know what I'm saying? I think there are a lot of things. You need to check your grandpa at the dinner table, right? You know, and also check him, you know, on a phone call, right? Check him in every situation. You need to check your boss. You know what I'm saying? You need to have those tough conversations. You need to check your mama, you know, check your sister. You know what I'm saying? I mean, like, there are so many different things that we could be doing, right? So the list goes on. You can crack open a book. I mean, please, that's one, maybe that's one thing, you know, read a book. I think a lot of times I've had a lot of questions about people asking me for information, which I love. Ask me for information, that's fine. I'm happy to give information. But, you know, a lot of times I can send you a book recommendation, and I have found a lot of power and knowledge in some of these books, you know what I'm saying? Just knowledge that I have not been exposed to. So maybe that's one big thing that white folks can do, is crack open a book. And learn really about this, right? You know what I'm saying? Learn deeper than what they tell you in other places. But I mean, the list goes on. If you need a referral, if you need a list, hit me up. We can strategize what's the best game plan for you. If you want to, you know, if you need me to consult on your on your organizing efforts, I can help with that. So hit me up.
I'll say there's three things that anyone that happens to be from the Caucasus region or hail from that in their lineage, that they could do, and that is to recognize, to speak up, and to take action. Black people definitely got the recognizing and speaking up part and the taking action part pretty much down. And I know that there's a lot of, I wouldn't say a lot, but there's definitely some Black people out there that are like, no, we don't need any help from the white people, they're oppressors, blah, blah, blah. I don't believe that at all. If you are a white person and you do want to help, recognize through education that, yo, you have privilege. There is a system that is against people of color and underrepresented groups from elevating and being in the same positions that you guys are just naturally. And then to speak up, like Imokhai was saying, check your mom, your dad, your family, your dog, everybody that you know that is against the advancement of underrepresented groups. Take a stand, be firm, especially people that are inside of the same faith as me as Christians. That's something that Jesus Christ calls you to do. You need to stand up and be firm in the stance against it. Too often do I see the hesitancy in that. And then action, just like Imokhai was saying, there are so many bailout funds that you could be donating to. There are so many different protests that you could be going to if you are willing to be there. There's so many things that you can do. And please come talk to me. I'm not always having the energy to talk about it every single day, but I would love to be there to help educate, and I would love to be there to help guide and direct if I can. And don't ever hesitate to ask any Black person. Let me rephrase that. Don't hesitate to ask your Black friends, because the worst thing they can say is no, or not right now. So
be okay with that no. And don't ask why, just be okay with it and move on.
Hey, like my brother said, man, hey, if you're a white person, man, you cannot be silent. You got to stand your ground. You got to check people. You got to speak up. You can't take all this and don't say anything, don't do anything about it. But if you want to do something, you got to make some actions. Make a petition. Go to your local church and have a chance to speak up and just talk about the issue. I know it's a difficult conversation, but once you do it multiple times, it will get easier and easier. So I say, don't be silent. Do a lot of action in your schools. Make some organizations, make some clubs. Also, if you're an adult, start committees within your work to show that we can't stand for this, that there's something wrong with it. And also too, educate yourself. If a white person don't know what's going on, educate yourself to see what's going on, and then ask yourself, is it fair? Is it just? And if you feel it's not unjust, then stand up for that and speak out.
Thank you everyone. I just want to add a brief information in here. As an educational sociologist and a person who studies race, I think it's important, and work in that field every day, I think it's important that if you are white, that and you are an ally and you want to do something, the first thing is to know that it is not a person of color's job to educate you. There are people like myself. There are people like, you know, Caleb mentioned it, Imokhai, Frantz mentioned it, that would be willing to talk with you and do some education. But it is exhausting to be asked constantly and to be expected to have your experience and your frame of reference serve as the predominant overlaying experience and answer for all Black people, all Black men. And so this series is called Perspectives with Black Men, and that's from different age ranges and different perspectives and different experiences, so that you can see that we all don't come from a monolithic viewpoint. I somewhat agree and disagree with Imokhai's point about the blackout thing. I'm a firm believer in trying to buy from Black businesses and Black business owners first before I go out other places. But that is my personal belief. I don't demean anyone who don't believe that. But we do have Black people who don't believe that. We have Black Republicans who believe that Trump is doing a great job. I won't even say.
I do want to be clear. I 100% believe in these blackout campaigns in the sense of like us buying from Black business. What I was not a fan of is those Black Box, Blackout Tuesday. Oh, okay. They post a Black Box on social media. That was my issue.
My apologies. So we do agree.
Yeah, we do agree on that. Maybe, we will 100% agree on that. Yeah, also, I think it's important to know people to know too. You have to be able to build perspective and get plenty of people's opinions, right? Because at the same time, like you listening to Imokhai's hot take on racism is not your all you need to know about racism, right? You know what I'm saying? Like, and so there's so much more. It's so much deeper than, you know, my hot take on a Tuesday and 150 characters, right? So you really need to be able to like take a step away from social media and like open a book, you know? So.
And there's one book that I recommend all white people read, and anybody who wants to work in this field. Dr. Robin DiAngelo wrote this book called White Fragility. It is the, in my opinion, the quintessential text that really dives through why white people have a difficult problem with talking about race, even when they know that racism exists. And I think she does a great, beautiful job. She doesn't pay me at all, But if there was one text that I would recommend, and I have a whole host of others, actually many of them are right here on my desk now that I could recommend, but that would be probably the number one text that I would recommend for a white person who's interested in reading more. So we have another question. It might be the same answer, so I'm just gonna ask you if this is your, if the answer you just gave was the same or if you have something different. But as an African-American woman, how do we stand strong behind our Black men? Akil, do you have anything else to add to that? Is that a different answer than the one you just gave?
I'll try to be short, but I think that any encouragement is a lot of encouragement, and that you know, that support system is definitely needed, and I think that it is very powerful, and I think that we have to stand beside each other. And we have to continue to uplift each other, because they're just as much as Black men have a fight that they're facing, Black women are double minorities, and they need the support and encouragement just as much. So it's definitely not easy, but something that, you know, I think you just encourage, uplift and support. And in return, you know, Black men would have to, and do the same thing.
I wouldn't necessarily say my answer is different. I think people just have to find their place in the movement, right? Find what it is that they're passionate about, what it is they wanna do. I feel compelled to say this, not necessarily because of the question, but this, you know, movement and where we're at in life, it's bigger than just, you know, Black men at this point, right? You know what I'm saying? It's Black women, it's Black trans people, you know what I'm saying? It's just like, it's the entire, you know, Black LGBTQ community, right? And so I think it's important that we understand this is about Black lives. And so we need to be saying her name, right? Breonna Taylor. You know, we need to be talking about each and every Black life that's out there. And so it's really not just about us standing behind Black men, right? It's about us standing behind Black folks, period.
I'll say I'm with Imokhai, where it's not Black men, it's Black people of color. We need to stand behind the full wholeheartedly. I would also say that along with that, there needs to be a little bit of a healing, and by a little bit, I mean a lot of bit of a healing between Black men and Black women, because I know that from my experience, how Black men treat Black women in some spaces and in some instances is less than desirable, and in others is absolutely abhorrent. And I know that Black women, because of hurt and pains in the past, have now ascribed a label to all Black men, which also is not helpful towards us coming together as one Black people and uplifting one another and bringing each other closer towards our goal of being seen as equal, or being treated as equal within the United States of America and across the whole globe. So I definitely believe that that is something that needs to be addressed and taken care of as well. And we can all then move forward as a people.
I say for what Black women can do is just encourage us, because like my counterpart said, Black lives matter. And then we all have the same color skin within the Black community. So we're going to encourage each other to stand by side. Don't be silent. Keep fighting. Keep being in this battle. Keep, so we can win this war. Keep your head up. Don't keep your head down. And if we, for some reason, we have our head down, help us put our head back up.
Thank you. That was some powerful words. One of the things I want to add just to what everybody else said is every one of the panelists here, as well as myself, have talked about the role that their mother has played in their life and the support that they provide. We know in the Black community, just with fictive kinship, that we don't only have mother. We do have the biological mother. You know, my mother passed 3 years ago, three summers ago. And I have so many women who play mother figure roles for me and have made sure that they lift me up during that time and others in moments when I would have called my mother. So That's the thing I would say about women, Black women, or any women who woman who wants to provide support. You can be, you can play that role as well. You can definitely play that role because we all need a good auntie, right? So last question, and then that will be, we'll wrap up, is if we think about the future, knowing that each and every one of you, we have a 10-year gap or more between myself and all of you, but I wanna know just from your thoughts, you know, what are some innovative ways to begin changing? Like, what does change look like from your perspective?
I think that, you know, for me, change looks like educating and preparing myself to go and do the same for somebody else. I think there are some things that, you know, I have been working on this year. Me and a colleague of mine, we were starting a mentoring program. We had an AAU program that we were starting. And the thing with the AAU program is that basketball was just a vehicle for the kids to be able to come together, have something that kept them out of the streets. It's had something that informed them educationally, that encouraged them, that taught them that they can go and obtain a college degree or graduate high school and go to college and give them some type of hope. And I think that right now that's something that we need more than ever, is a opportunity that provides hope, an opportunity that provides inspiration. I think when you think about the things that you can do, is that you can get, you know, pull a young man under your right arm, pull one under your left arm and say, hey, this is what, you know, you need to do. These are the opportunities that you have. This is the hope that I'm able to share with you. And for me, it was through a mentoring program. It is through public speaking. It is through maybe getting somebody who's educated in financial literacy, getting somebody who's educated in sports or in education or music or entertainment or those things that may be vehicles, and say, hey, this is your path, step by step, step one, step two, step three, of how things can be done. And I'm a firm believer in, you know, power and numbers coming together. And if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And people coming together in communities to support businesses, to build businesses, to create economic opportunity, to create financial opportunities, and doing that within our own community. So those are some of the things that, you know, I'm excited about and encouraged more than ever to really kick in the gear and be able to work on, because no matter who you are, I believe that you can make it, you are big enough to make a difference.
You know, for me, I feel as though, you know, we have a very bright future, very hopeful future. You know, I believe that we will win, and I'm very determined to get that win, whatever it looks like in my lifetime. I do want to shout out the Freedom Block. You know, the Freedom Block is an innovative organization here in Northeast Ohio. It's doing a lot of political education that has solutions. You know, their executive director is Ray Green, from right here in Akron, Ohio. And they got, you know, an extensive plan, right? They got demands right here for Akron, Ohio, right here for Summit County. And I'm just going to read a couple of them for you all right here, just for us to be kind of aware, maybe for you to think on. Number one, state and local lawmakers ensure that the police are patrolling the Black community, are from similar Black communities, and or have intensive and extensive cultural competency training, along with implicit bias training, and have to volunteer in the community that they are patrolling at least 10 hours a month. Number two, deputy mayor, city council, and police chief work with community leaders and Black mental health agencies to develop, provide, and make mandatory mental health training for all APD officers in order to ensure that our mental health population is treated with dignity and respect. Number three, we want 25% of the police budget to go to the prevention programs in the inner city and to asset forfeiture programs. Be widely publicized to ensure that the folks on the front lines doing the actual work have the necessary resources to make the community actually better. Number four, we are demanding that our police auditor be given the necessary tools to investigate properly and discipline rogue police officers, that a community civilian review board is made up of civilians from each ward and instituted immediately. These tools include, but are not limited to, subpoena power and disciplinary powers to ensure the Black community is able to build trust and trust rogue officers will be disciplined and removed from Black communities where they have done harm. And the last one, number five, is that we are demanding that the police be removed from all public schools. You hear that, NJ? All public schools, and be replaced with mental health trained community resource personnel. So those are five things that the Freedom Bloc is demanding here in Akron. I think those are five things that we might be able to get on board with. So just food for thought.
As far as change is concerned, I believe that what it looks like in the future is a change in the religious realm, because I remember learning in school, but again, in my own research as well, that Martin Luther King Jr. and even Malcolm X both came from very religious backgrounds, and that a lot of our religious leaders right now are only about the wealth. At least the prominent ones that I see and that a lot of people see are about wealth and gaining wealth. But we need religious leaders that are prominent about social change and reform as well. And we need them being back on the front lines like they used to, being back on the front lines of those protests, arm in arm with the protesters like they used to. I also believe that there needs to be an economic change in the way that we educate economically and the way that we actually go about those economics. Again, supporting Black businesses, making sure that our children are trained in financial literacy, but then also knowledgeable on how to be entrepreneurs, whether or not that is their calling or whether or not that is something they want to go towards. At least you will understand how to move in the business realm, because those are very useful skills. I also think that just change in how we perceive people that are outside of our communities as well, because I know as soon as I got in contact with Black communities, because I grew up in white communities a lot growing up until I reached a certain age, about 13, 14 years old, we need to change how we perceive the people around us as well, because I feel like there is a lot of stereotypes that are held within the Black community that is, again, from a lot of generational pain passed down, but it's not helping anybody to continue to hold on to that generational pain and that generational stereotypes that we've continually perpetuated within our own communities as well, not just about outside groups, but within people groups as well, because colorism is very rampant within the Black community, and it's pretty ridiculous, in my opinion, that we're at each other's necks when we should all be together moving in the same direction. Just as Akil said, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go with one another and with the community.
I say what change look like is basically educate our community first. Educate our community, showing them that the answer is to vote, to show how their power of voting can help them change the leader of our nation and what their values of how we can help change the whole nation as a whole. So I say educate our communities first. And then once we educate our communities, then we branch off and then have that community that we educated to go out and to talk to one person, talk to two person, so then they can educate those individuals. And then those individuals can talk to other people. And then you can just like one little wildfire can just spread to show that we have to vote. We have to vote. Voting right now, I believe we, the dark side or the good side, we have to get everybody on board to go for a change. And I feel like voting is the answer.
Wow. So thank you very much, Imokhai, Akil, Caleb, and Frantz, for participating in this discussion today. I just want to say a few things about what change looks like and some of the stand on what you all said. We do need to come together. One part of coming together, honestly, there's still time to fill out the census. We need as many people to fill out the census. With census comes resources. If you're counted appropriately, more resources. As well as that is used to decide who your representatives are. And so if we want to continue with gerrymandered districts with in our communities being mixed in with potentially some communities so far away and that have very different issues as us, then that census will help change that, as well as voting, as Frantz mentioned. And also voting in your local elections. Local elections do matter. And as a locally elected leader for our schools, I just want to say that that's how I got there. And I think that they're important. Specifically, personally, I am a very local person. So I believe that we definitely need to pay attention to local. Again, thank you everyone for viewing in. This is the second part of a 10-part series of a web series that will end up going on for a while. Our next session is on Sunday. So most of them for the next month is focused on race and coming up with a call to action from perspectives of Black men. And so this call to action hopefully will go out broadly for things that we can do in our communities on the local level, on the state level, on the national level to call for changes and for things that we can do collectively and that you can ask and advocate for your representatives to call for as well. All from Black men. And so we'll have almost 40 Black men by the end of this series who will be weighing in, as well as some allies. So our last session will be on allies. But our next session is those Black men who are elected to lead. And so I am proud to introduce the elected leaders that will be on our panel next week. We have Ohio State Senator Dr. Vernon Sykes will be on next week. We also will have Ohio State Representative Philip Robertson will be on as well. We have County Commissioner in Michigan, Daniel Mahoney, who will also be on, as well as this just in, as of while we were having this discussion, we will have City Councilman Bashir Jones out of Cleveland on as well. So please join us next week as we have this conversation around Black men who are elected to lead, as we talk about elections and voting being important. Just having one person isn't enough, but we need to be able to create a critical mass and we need to support them. So we'll hear from their experiences and hear conversations around how change looks like and what we can do moving forward from those who are elected to lead. So thank you again, everyone, for participating. And we will definitely see you on Sunday at 8:30. Thank you, panelists.
Thank you, yes. NJ.
No problem.
Appreciate you, NJ. All right, boys, be safe out there, man.
Yeah, you do the same.